And I praise God that you didn't let go.
Amen.
I praise God that you chose to sing your song.
Yes.
A song of hope. I praise God that you are here today.
Amen.
And I praise God that you didn't let go. Because most of us come to some point in our life when we feel like giving up. Because that's the way life is. And I'm thankful that we have a God who gives us a song when we reach those moments. Sometimes we don't even know how to pray.
Yes.
We have a Spirit who prays in us and through us. In our scripture today, Jesus experiences the heights of glory. As the crowds cheer, "Blessed is the one who comes in the name of our God." It's difficult to imagine what that moment was like as Jesus passed through the streets of Jerusalem with amazing glory and amazing praise. But let's try to imagine that just a little bit today. I invite you at this moment to imagine yourselves there in Jerusalem. Jesus is passing through, and you are so excited you cannot contain yourself. So when I raise my hand, I invite all of you to cheer as loudly as you can.
Partner says, "I have something we need to talk about."
what do you mean divorce? How can it go from praise to pain so quickly? How does it all get mixed together? And what do we do when that happens? What happens when life changes on a dime or the loss thereof? One thing that I've learned is that I'm going through a time like that, and someone says it's going to get better. That sounds really hollow. When I'm going through something like that, and someone says, well, there's a reason for it, there's a reason for everything, I'm like, okay, tell me the reason. The cliches, the quick fixes, the self-help stuff, it just seems so hollow in times like that. How do we get through it? I think what I've learned is that the only way through is through. The only way out is through, and preferably not alone. And I think that's where the life of Jesus and our lives intersect. I think that Jesus, who walked through the streets of Jerusalem, who paraded through the streets of Jerusalem and heard the crowds shouting and later heard the crowds booing, is also the Jesus not just of Jerusalem, but the Jesus of Bethlehem. The Jesus who meets us at the intersections of our life. So when the only way through is through, how do we get through? And I think that's why we need this story today. That's why even for Jesus it's so important that it wasn't just glory. But it's not just glory for us. When we just have to get through, I think Jesus meets us at our intersection. And I think the invitation at that time is to take on the mind of Christ. That's how to begin to move our way through. I know that when I'm going through a time like that, that the Duane mind isn't really all that effective. The Duane mind tends to awfulize things. One thing goes wrong, and immediately my mind begins to go to what's going to happen next, and what's going to happen next. And it begins to take something that's bad and make it even worse. My mind tends to turn in on itself, and I find myself in that place of wanting to let go. The mind of Duane also tries to fix everything. Hopefully fix it as quickly as possible. That's why I need the Christ mind. The mind that leans into divine strength. The mind that somehow finds an ability to sing even when it seems the song has been lost. That mind that offers a place of courage. I don't have the courage that I need. Apostle Paul said, let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus. The same mind that got him through his betrayal, his fear. The same mind that kept Jesus going so that we would also know the way. So what does it mean to have the same mind that was in Christ Jesus? Mary Donovan Turner of the School of Religion says, to have the mind of Christ means we are called to resist contemporary expectations. To have the mind of Christ means we are to embody a different kind of community in what we see and experience around us. In a world where greed, the accumulation of wealth, and staying on top are the primary goals. A world where trickery and scam, appearances, deception, and illusion of the dynamics of everyday life. In that kind of world, we are called to be different. This is not a call to become celebrity or to hold to a me-first mentality. This is a call to release our arrogance and become servants of all. This is a call to lose our lives. And when we lose them, we find them. To take on the mind of Christ is to think counter-culture, To take on the mind of Christ is no, it's not just about us. It's our ego that gets us in trouble. It's our ego that awfulizes everything. Beyond our ego, there is love, there is compassion, and there is passion. And there is the will to keep taking one step at a time, just as Jesus did. We're trying to go through. Intersect our mind with the mind of Christ, the mind of God, the mind of love. In other words, reach out. When we reach out, love reaches back. And that's the next element here. We can get through because we know that Jesus has felt what we feel. Jesus also came to the moment in his life when he thought he'd lost his son. Jesus came to a time in his life when he heard the boos of the crowd, when he heard them shouting, "Crucify him," that he wanted to pass that cup. Jesus' life was real just as our life is real. When we face betrayal, we know that Jesus too faced betrayal. Jesus' life was a real life intersecting with our real life. He came to that moment when he prayed, my God, why have you forsaken me? If it be your will, let this cup pass. He felt what we feel. And yet he continued to take one step at a time. He continued to pray one prayer at a time. I think that's the deepest meaning of this Holy Week, is knowing that we're never alone. That a God of unconditional love is a God willing to share our conditions, whatever they are. I don't know about you, but I would have a hard time believing in a God who wasn't willing to get real with the real stuff of life. Some God who's just up there somewhere watching everything happen, caring from a distance. Our God is a God who cares up close, hand in hand, heart to heart. The writer of Hebrews knew this about God, knew this when calling for hope. The writer says, strengthen your drooping hands and your weak knees. Make steady paths for your feet, so that if any part of you is wounded, it will be healed, rather than injured more seriously. This is not a cliche, but a real life. This is not a quick fix, but a way of being. Life can change so quickly. And our God is with us in absolutely every change. Even when we don't feel that presence is there. Dan Clavin, in his web scene, Journey with Jesus, introduced me to Kate Ballard. She is 35 years old. She's currently a professor at Duke Divinity School. She's recently published an incredible book called Blessed, A History of the American Prosperity Gospel. She is really climbing in her career and is highly respected. And she was recently diagnosed with stage 4 cancer. She knows what it is to receive all that praise and then to receive the diagnosis that draws her to her knees. She writes, the stomach cramps I was suffering from were not caused by a faulty gallbladder, but a massive tumor. She knows what it is to experience praise and then to experience absolute anger, including some anger towards God. And by the way, God can take anger. God's big enough for that. God's big enough for whatever it is we may be feeling. She looked at her kids, her husband, is trying to make sense of this, and she still has not fully made sense of it. But this is what she says. Cancer has also ushered in new ways of being alive. In my vulnerability, I am seeing my world without the Instagrammed filter of greasy certainties and perfectible moments. I can't help noticing the brittleness of the ways that keep most people fed, sheltered, and whole. And yet I find myself returning to the same thoughts again and again. Life is so beautiful, and life is so hard. The reality of our faith is both are true. And through it all, we are blessed, not in some superficial sense, but in some real way. We are blessed when the praise touches us from the tips of our toes to the tops of our heads, and we twirl, and we dance, and we sing. And somehow our God of the hard places reminds us that even then, when we've cried so many tears, it seems we have no more left, that even there we're blessed. God, not alone. God is with us through it all. So this is the day to know who we are as God's people. People of praise, but people of pain, but people through all who are beloved. In just a few moments, we'll be blessing the ministry of our theologian, writer, and residence, Dr. Robin Gorslein. But in his poem for this day, he writes these words. This is the day that God has made for us to wake up, grow up, look up, act up, stand up, live up to our heritage as the people of God, led by the one who heals, exhorts, raises the dead, loves our enemies as much as he loves us, and never, ever stops feeding us, all of us, heavenly food we need. And crave, if we are honest with ourselves, to live by the meat, the truth, the beauty of God. Life is so beautiful, and life is so hard. And through it all, we are God's beloved community. Again, I'm so glad you're here today. And I'm so glad you didn't give up.
Amen.
I'm so glad you're here today. And I'm so glad you didn't let go. God be praised. Amen.